I returned from college knowing everything that first summer, yeah. And I sat my brothers down, you know, for a late night conversation to lay out the problems of the world to them. You know, so fired up about it. And my oldest brother was like, listen, you either gotta stop talking about this or you have to do something about it. Our pump is, you know, this big. It's about the size of an American football. It's 4 kilograms.
That's
so they'll look at it and they'll be like, no, that's not big enough.
Yeah.
And then they'll turn it on or we'll show a video of the water flowing and they're like, oh yeah, I'll take that.
Katie, extremely excited to get to know you and your background a little bit more. We had a one-on-one, but we didn't get to go there. And so to me, this is a chance to get to know you a little bit better. Can we start with, where are you from?
I'm from Washington, D.C., in this city, yeah.
Yeah. And what was your upbringing like?
My upbringing was terrific. Yeah. I've got two older brothers. We're spaced out by 2 years each, so it's everyone was in the house all the time. There was a lot of rough housing, a lot of sports.
Yeah.
It was terrific. We have, my parents are wonderful people, very supportive. And I've got a good community of friends in D.C.
Yeah, that
was a good place to grow up.
And is your family still in D.C.? Or?
Yeah, my parents are still there. Brothers are spread along the eastern side of the U.S.
Yeah.
But we all go back to D.C. often enough. And my Nana's there, too. Yeah.
And do they think, how do they feel about your work in India in particular?
They're all so excited about it.
Really? Yeah.
I think my Nana's the only one who's a little less enthused because I'm not around as much and FaceTime is still very confusing to her what's going on when they show the screen of me there.
Yeah.
But even when I, you know, and I explain to her over and over, she's lost a bit of her memory, what's going on. She gets really excited.
Yeah.
She's totally behind it.
Yeah. Yeah. And so when did this journey start for you?
You know, it started at my first college. I was in liberal arts school. I was at Pomona College. And my freshman year, I was taking everything in. I was doing Qigong and sculpture. And and I was studying environmental science. And I was studying anthropology. And of course, as everyone does, I returned from college knowing everything that first summer.
Yeah.
And I sat my brothers down, you know, for a late night conversation to lay out the problems of the world to them. Which they, of course, took, you know, not so well. But I remember just talking about these environmental problems, these populations who don't have options. And I was, you know, so fired up about it. And my oldest brother was like, listen, you either got to stop talking about this or you have to do something about it. And in that same night, we brainstormed, we talked through, and they were like, you were always good at math. You like building things. How about engineering? And so I went back to school, and you couldn't study engineering at Pomona. There was no degree for it. But there was this program. It was 3 years at Pomona, two at Caltech. No one had done it for a decade. Only one woman had ever done it before, and that was 25 years before. So I started trying to do that and made that my path. Luckily got into Caltech and struggled through Caltech. I was, again, well prepared in Qigong and sculpture, less prepared in math and physics. So that was a real challenge, but I was determined. I showed up to Caltech first day and they had, you know, a student office. And this was when people were, you know, getting into their dorms, going to Target with their parents and things. And I was a transfer student. My friend Lucy took me. And we went to the student office, and I was like, who can I speak to about getting some tutors? And they were like, sorry? And I was like, I'm going to need 5 tutors for my 5 classes. And they were like, this isn't how this usually works.
Yeah.
But I made it work and learned some hard skills at Caltech and did some really exciting research. And that was how I got to graduate school, where at MIT, me and my co-founders were all part of the Tata Fellowship.
So what is that?
Yeah, it's a fellowship at MIT and IIT Bombay. It's a sister fellowship where the Tata Trust invested money in these universities to attract scientific talent to work on the problems that affect the Indian people. So it was through this fellowship that we were able to travel to India many times throughout our master's degrees. And while we were all doing research on slightly different things, you know, I was doing drip irrigation and trying to develop a low pressure drip irrigation emitter. So it was a lot of physics, fluid mechanics, modeling, things like that. My co-founder was doing microgrids in India and mapping of that. But it was through that that we kind of danced around and were talking to all the stakeholders and found out that in these areas, and since India is such an agrarian place and 85% of the farms in India are small plot farms.
85%.
85%. Yeah, it's not like the U.S. where you've got these massive farms. It's like a ton of tiny farms. The biggest problem for them wasn't necessarily drip and having something like that. It was just being able to irrigate year-round.
Just water.
Yeah. And it was something that we figured out that our technical skill set could contribute to solving that problem.
And did you spend a lot of time with farmers in these markets? Like, how did you realize this was the problem? How did you really learn that this was an issue?
My other co-founder, Kevin, was absolutely instrumental in that. It was the farmers, it was the NGOs, government employees, it was so many different people were saying this is the hole. And it's really along that way, it's been a great number of stakeholders to check in with and be like, hey, are we on the right path? And all signs point to yes. So that was, the design process was intense and it was a lot of time in the field, which is great. The farmers we piloted with, their very first system, they've been using it for 2 years now, and they've you know, given us so much feedback that we've incorporated. It's been, the user-centered design process is really important to us.
So one of our mentors at Unreasonable, Paul Pollock, who you know, I think you know all about him.
Absolutely, he's brought
arguably about 20 million small plot farmers, rural farmers, out of poverty with irrigation systems. He has a quote I love where he says 20% of, you know, the equation is coming up with the technology. And that's kind of, that's the fun, that's the sexy part. 80%, the really hard part is getting it to market. And so I know you're still in that process, but what is, well, actually first tell us about the technology. And then let's talk about what's hard about getting that to market.
Yeah. We 1,000% agree, though. It's completely right that technology is just a slice of the problem or the solution. We identified the most time, I think, was spent in trying to figure out the performance point, which means the amount of water you get out of a solar pump each day and what kind of depth that you want to draw from. And East India is the Gangetic River Basin, so there's actually tons of groundwater right there. So it's really shallow groundwater. And then these small plot farmers, 1 acre and smaller, since there's 30 million across the region, really densely packed. Yeah, really densely packed in. That 1 acre farm was how we determined that performance point. The technology was an iterative process at MIT where we were focused on making a hyper-efficient pump, because with an incredibly efficient pump, then the amount of solar panels you need comes way, way down, and with less panels, the system becomes affordable, which was, of course, the main barrier for entry for these farmers. In terms of technology just being a part of the solution, it's completely true. I think our greatest strength there has been our support from Tata Trust. They have a massive network of NGOs, and they themselves, you know, are a giant NGO. So they've connected us through different NGOs to farmers all across the region. And that's been a really important education, marketing, and feedback loop for us.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of what we've been... I'm talking about a lot of nights is what is hardest about this journey as an entrepreneur. But I'm curious, what's most fun? Like, what do you love about this?
What's most fun? There's that eyes light up moment when the farmer first, you know, plugs the pump and solar panels together and water comes out. because these farmers, right, diesel pumps are these big, massive things. It takes two people to carry it. They put sticks there and they can carry it. So a lot of the farmers haven't seen solar before. Mm. So that's one eyes light up thing. But the other one is our pump is, you know, this big. It's about the size of an American football. It's 4 kilograms.
That's
so
it.
They'll look at it and they'll be like, no, that's not big enough. Like, that's not going to irrigate my field.
Yeah.
And then they'll turn it on or we'll show a video of the water flowing. And they're like, oh, yeah, I'll take that. I'd like that.
So cool.
So that eyes light up moment is really exciting for us. Other fun, I love my co-founders. We have an amazing working dynamic, such a support system. You know, we moved to India a year and a half ago, which, of course, was a big transition. And I certainly couldn't have or wouldn't have enjoyed it the way I have without Victor, my co-founder in India. So yeah, we make sure that it's a really a good environment to work and grow in.
So if this is wildly successful, like you bring so much heart and so much intelligence to this work, I'm curious, like, the scale at which you're really thinking or hoping that this achieves.
Global, for sure. There's small plot farmers in East India, in Nepal, in Bangladesh, in Indonesia, all over the world who could benefit from this system. There's economies who could benefit from pushing towards their food security goal. East India is near and dear to our hearts because we've spent so much time there. We designed with those farmers. We designed for them. But we're certainly not limiting ourselves or limiting the impact that it could have globally.
And maybe one last question. You were curious with the entrepreneurs here, right, what they would tell themselves if they could go back to the start when they were 2 years into their company. But I'm curious what you would tell yourself if you could go back to the start when you, like, truly started the company. What advice would you give yourself?
When we started the company, I think I would either say, I think I'd tell myself to move to India sooner. We spent 6 months in the U.S. and when we decided to move, it was an awkward time. But it was just that we'd had the we needed to be closer to the customers. It was insane to be taking these multinational trips or across the world. And if we'd moved sooner, it would have made a lot of sense. If we'd moved a bit later, it would have made sense too, but we wouldn't have been as close to the customers. When we did move, was not the best fit for the business. So I would have gone sooner and made that change.
So that'd be your advice to any engineer, any entrepreneur?
Maybe, Ask me in like 5 years, I'm sure I'll have more advice for myself back then.
Well, Katie, it's such a privilege to have you in this portfolio and part of this community, and we all have your back, and that vision that you have, I think it will be achieved. So thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Yeah.